Welcome back to the Budget Gamer channel, where we bring you critical and in-depth reviews of just about every indie game we can get our hands on, and today we're going to be taking a look at In Between for the Nintendo Switch. And whether you did some deep research or maybe just saw this game on sale for over 90% off on the eShop, you're probably already aware that it touts itself as yet another innovative story-driven puzzle platformer. But depending on your own gaming background, those words might be more open to interpretation. The main story of the game, though, is deep and moving as it deals with life reflections and retrospection of an older man as he looks back on his life after a long and losing battle with terminal cancer. As such, the opening scenes of the game find our withered protagonist in a wheelchair barely strong enough to lift himself out of his own bed. But quickly, as the professional voice acting and monologues start retelling the tales of his life and his current situations, our main character leaps out of his wheelchair and gains health as well as youth as he goes back in time deeper and deeper into his memories. However, as you might determine for yourself looking at the gameplay's footage, though In Between does offer 60 unique different levels of gameplay, it may be the game's graphics and professional voice acting that do eventually become the main draw for the player. Every one of the game's 60 levels will offer the player a pseudo-platforming obstacle course where they'll be required to navigate past traps and obstacles and a myriad of spikes with a pixel-on-pixel one-touch death mechanic. But despite the need to navigate your main character from entry point A to final point B with the occasional checkpoint thrown in between for longer levels, there is actually no ability to jump. And this is pretty much where the game's main platforming innovation comes in. Without the ability to jump, the only way you'll be able to move around the course, besides controlling your character either left or right, is to flip gravity. With the left joystick, as mentioned before, you'll be able to move your character left or right, but with the right joystick, you'll be able to change the gravity of the area you're navigating through either up, down, left, or right. In making use of this game dynamic, you'll be able to stick to walls, ceilings, and floors to puzzle your way through this obstacle course. And while this main staple of gameplay will be consistent throughout the game's 60 levels, the levels are divided into 6 different chapters, which, when discounting the tutorial, fall along the 5 stages of grief. And whether the chapter is devoted to anger, denial, depression, or what have you, each of the new chapters will introduce a new gaming element. And each of these elements, whether it's bubbles of rage or creeping darkness of depression, will require you to navigate through each of these puzzling courses in new and unique ways. Occasionally in each course, as well as between each chapter, we'll be exposed to more and more of the main character's memories of their life gone by. And while the between chapter cutscenes are a little bit longer of a dialogue, within each level stumbling upon an occasional blank spot in the canvas, you may encounter just a small fraction of the memory that'll give just that much deeper of an insight into a specific situation the main character may have struggled with. Overall, the gameplay is fairly consistent in its puzzling simplicity, and the story probably will be the biggest draw for anyone who sticks with the game and plays till the end. However, if you are even remotely familiar with the 5 stages of grief, it is pretty easy to forecast where the story is going. And as this might either be a positive or a negative depending on what type of player you are, this might be a pretty good transition point to start talking about some of the game's critiques. First off, the game isn't necessarily story-driven as much as it is story-based. There's really nothing about the story that pushes the actual gameplay forward other than being one of the only things that would cause a player to invest in the game. It is a deep and moving narrative, and it definitely sucks in the player, but the gameplay mechanics compared to the story, well, this story could be told in pretty much any type of gameplay scenario, so there doesn't really seem to be a very vivid connection. Regardless of the story, though, if you are playing this game as a puzzle platformer, there are a few mechanical issues you might want to be aware of. One, as mentioned earlier, is the pixel-on-pixel death mechanic. And while this isn't necessarily a bad thing, it does make the margin for error in the gameplay incredibly minute. So instead of casually puzzling your way through due to certain puzzle obstacles, or even speedily platforming your way through, you'll be required more to rely on trial and error. All areas will require expert precision, and some areas will require some pretty expert timing, leaving you to blindly stumble into what seem to be some pretty cheap kills. Additionally, the game's controls consist of the left and right thumbstick. And while altering the gravity of the game in 4 directions with the right thumbstick does actually feel fairly intuitive, one thing that stuck out is not intuitive is the character control. You'll only be able to move your character left or right. And unfortunately, with the left thumbstick, there's only a finite range in that 360 degrees that will cause your character to respond toward right or left movement. And so in that sense, it seems like being able to use the directional buttons, even just for a quality of life improvement, would have been way more intuitive and helped the player out a lot. All of these aforementioned issues combined do create some fairly impassable difficulty spikes, which the game developers did seek to remedy. Each of the game's chapters only has a certain number of levels you're actually required to pass to complete the chapter, and as such, if you get to a level that you just can't beat, you can skip it and move on. But, and this may just be my opinion, that almost seems like a lazy solution to a bad game balance. In total, though, while I did find the game's visuals and its music, and especially the professional voice acting and the deep narration to be really satisfying and a really solid experience, I personally found the gameplay itself to be fairly lacking. After the first few levels, you really do experience pretty much all the game has to offer, except for the story, and the intense difficulty spikes in gameplay were a bit frustrating. But for under a buck, as long as it's still on sale, if you are interested in seeing some good visuals, hearing some professional voice acting, or maybe subjecting yourself to a bit of a trial and error obstacle course, In Between might not exactly be a bad game. But if you're watching this review after it comes off sale and you're debating paying full price, I would encourage you to wait until it goes back on sale. But anyway, that does about wrap up the review of In Between now on the Nintendo Switch, so if you liked the review, or especially if you found it helpful, feel free to throw me a like or a comment to show your support. And don't forget to click that little bell icon when you subscribe to stay updated with the latest content. There are new and unique indies coming out literally every single day, so there's always going to be some cool new game to find out about right here. But if you want to get more involved with the channel, or just see what I'm up to, or talk to some of your fellow gamers, you can click any of the links in the bottom right corner of our channel's banner for Instagram, Twitter, Patreon, or even our channel's Discord. But anyway, this has been Budget Gamer, so as always, thanks for watching.